Аз ви предлагам да открием днешния ден с презентацията, виждате, краудсорсинг, или на български официално го превеждаме ангажираност на тълпата за решаване на сериозни въпроси. И вчера бяхме споменали в представенето точно на професор Билат Равид, че въпроси, които повече от 15 години на времето не са били разрешаеми, започват да се решават именно използвайки този подход. И така, аз бих искала да поканя професор Билат Равид да представи своята разработка тук, специално направена за вас. I would like to invite you.
So I'm going to talk this morning about crowdsourcing, and I will start presenting a few framework that will help us to understand or to analyze what is a crowdsourcing. After the frameworks, I will talk a little bit about the wisdom of crowds, what makes us as a crowd smarter than each one individually. And then I will start to speak about crowdsourcing. I will define what exactly is crowdsourcing. And the rest of the presentation or the lecture will be a lot of examples of crowdsourcing sites. And most of the sites, I will show you a short video that presents the sites and the idea behind it. And the main motivation for this is to show you many examples of crowdsourcing. And there are many, many more that I show you that I can show in 1 hour, which is a good example of many cases of crowdsourcing. So let's start with a few frameworks or models that help us understand the crowdsourcing phenomena. First of all, I want to talk a little bit about network utility. In our life, in our internet communication life, there is a connection between the group size and the utility of the network. If we think about Graham Bell, the phone inventor, he worked very hard. He invited the phone, but then he was very lonely and disappointed. He had no one to call. He started to have utility from the phone only after he gave the first phone to his friend, and they could talk all day, Graham Bell and his friend. And after a while, he gave the second phone to another friend, and they could speak, Graham Bell with the first friend and Graham Bell with the second friend, and both friends between themselves. In communication network, the utility is related to n squared. This is the number of connections that we can make in a group. If we have n people in the group, each one of them can connect with n minus 1 other people, and the connection is without direction, so it's divided by 2. So it's going quite quickly high. This model is called Metcalfe model. The blue one, which is the model of utility in television, in newspaper, and other broadcasting systems, is called Sarnoff model, which is linear. In television, we measure rating. Success of a television program is a rating. Rating is a linear function. But these days, with Facebook and Twitter and Foursquare and other communication tools that we saw already yesterday, the utility is growing much, much faster. It's 2 by n, which is the number of groups that we can create in our system. In online form or in Facebook, you can create one large group of all your friends and two groups of, let's say we have 100 friends in our Facebook, we can make 100 people group, 299 people different groups, etc. If you sum all the combinations of the group, you get to this number of groups, which has grown much, much faster. Which means that in order to gain a better, higher utility to our customer, we need to grow or to attain a lot of people, and they will have utility by many of the people. Another example of the network utility model, if you think about YouTube or Wikipedia, if no one will upload video, no one will enjoy YouTube. YouTube is built on UCG, user UGC, user-generated content, which means that we rely on our friends to upload video in order that we will enjoy the system or the communication tool. So the first model is the network utility. But apparently, not all of our connections are equal. We have different kind of connections between our friends. If we take to the extreme, on one extreme, we have very strong connection. This is our intimate friend. This is our family. These are the people that give us support. The other kinds of friends that we have, it's very weakly connected friends. And the theory behind it is called the strength of weak ties by Granovetter from 1973, which is saying that there is strength of a weak ties. You're not so best friend, you're not BFF, best friend forever, also have some strengths, and the strength that they have, it's to bring us new information. If you want to find a new job, probably you will not find it through your strong connections. Your family or your best friends don't have enough information about new jobs. Because all the people that they know, you also know. Your friends' friends are also your friends. So if you think about your friends, they are a group of very, very strong friends which give you support. And there is a group of weak ties or weak friends that give you a lot of information. I can visualize it through Facebook. I will give you two examples. This is one example. This is my friends on Facebook. I am in the middle, and each dot here, it's one of my friends in Facebook. And you see the connections between my friends. And you see that there is a group of people that know each other, and they are friends between themselves. This is my strong ties. And there are a group of friends, they don't know each other. They are only my friends. This is one visualization of that. It's called Friends Wheel. I'm not sure the application is still working on Facebook. Other option to see it is with this visualization. If you want to do it for your Facebook account, you need to search for NetViz with double Z. At the end, it will generate a network file that you need to upload to a Gephi, which is a free software. Here you see friends of people that registered to my course, my knowledge management course at Ben Gurion University. Most of the students are industrial engineering students, and this is this size, but they have many other students that are not connected to any other people in my group. So here again, we see a group of strong ties, people that speak a lot, are a good friend between themselves, a separated, isolated group of students in that course. This is another course from other year. The third model that I want to mention, Andy, Dr. Veron actually showed you it yesterday. He called it Rumsfeld model. It's what we know and what we know and we know we don't know. And this actually is called in psychology Johari windows, after John and Harry, which was invited in 1955. So those are few models, among a lot of them, that can help us understand what's going on with crowdsourcing. So let's move for a while to the wisdom of crowds. And the thing that I'm talking about, the wisdom of the crowd, that if you are taking the crowds in and ask them to do something for us, we need to make sure that they are doing a good job. And they will do a good job if there will be wisdom as a group of people. So I will talk a little bit about wisdom of crowds when the group is smarter from each individual in the group. I will start with three examples or three cases that show that a group can be smarter than the individual. We have many ways to solve problems. And what I'm going to say is that we can also use the crowds as a problem solver. First example, Francis Galton. He was a cousin of Charles Darwin. He was English Victorian. He was scientist in many, many fields. And because he also looked about genetics and statistics, he used to go to agricultural fairs. And one day he got to agricultural fair in 1906, And he saw that the people there are betting about an ox. They put an ox on the display and try to guess what's the animal weight. And the ox was dressed in funny clothes, and everyone enjoyed, and the man that was the farmer that was closest to the actual weight of the ox get all the pot and they put the money inside it. And Galton disliked the idea of democracy, and he wanted to use this example of gambling on the ox weight to show that people can't get or can't decide smartly and can't get into a good voting about something. So he go to the man that organized this kind of game and ask him all the notes that they write the weight on them. There was 787 people that was in this matching from many different expertise. Some were experts, some were farmers, some were butchers, and other people, and some know nothing about oxes and weights. And they collect all the pieces, and he didn't look at the one that was the most close to the real weight of the ox, but he wanted to look at the average. And when he averaged the weight of the ox, he find that the average weight was 1,197 pounds. The actual weight of the ox was 1,198. Somehow the crowd know exactly what the ox weight is. Something in the average was right. It's not the man that said the right answers, but someone in the average, they were the right answer. If I had time, more than an hour of lecturing about crowdsourcing, I could ask you to write on a paper what is my age. And from tries that we do, a group in that order of people can guess quite easily what's an age of another one in the average. Although some will think that I'm youngest than I, and some think that I'm oldest, the mean, the average, will be the right number. The second example, what Galton discovered was that it's actually crowds of people can make surprisingly good decisions in the average, even if they have imperfect information. And Sorotsky, in his book about the wisdom of crowd, said under the right circumstances, and there is a big emphasis about the right circumstances, it's not happened every time. You need a special condition in order that the groups are remarkably intelligent and are often smarter than the smarter people in them. Groups do not need to be dominated by especially intelligent people in order to be smart. Even if most of the people within group are not especially well informed or rational, it can still reach collective wisdom decision. Second example is the Space Shuttle Challenger, which take off in January 28 and suddenly explode in the air a few seconds after the takeoff. In the American Bursa, the Nasdaq start to fall, and especially four companies fall sharply after this disaster. And after a while, the companies start to stable, and most of them recovered from the stock exchange markets fallen, apart from one. The Martin Sokol company continue to fall and fall and fall until they stop the stock exchange and reopen it, and it continue to fall in prices. Somehow the crowds blame Morton Thiokol, that she is the company that responsible for the explanation of the shuttle. It took another half a year for a scientific committee to investigate the case until they found that it was real Morton Thiokol's responsibility. If you remember, they designed the O-ring without consider the low temperature in the air, and the rubber broke and was not elastic anymore. So here again, example of how the crowd, via the stock exchange mechanism, know that someone is responsible for this disaster. Third example, and I think it's one of the amazing ones that I know about crowdsourcing. In 1968, a US submarine disappeared. No one knew what happened to her, where she were, why she sunk into the ocean. And then they decide to form a team of experts and to start to gambling about different questions. What do you think was the cause of the submarine when she sank? What do you think happened there? What the captain did when he realized that he had a problem? And because, and I remind you yesterday lecture, they have a motivation problem, or as we call it, motivatia, they gambling on a bottle of whiskey. And each one got a whiskey if he answered some good answer. At the end of the day, Craven, which was the chief scientist in the American Navy, collect all the answers, go to his room. He was one of the pioneers in Bayesian statistics. It's statistics that asks the questions, what the probability that A occur if we know that B occur? And he do all his math and come with the exact point that told the US Navy, search the submarine here. And they found the submarine 220 yards from that point, which is quite close. And again, it's a group of people that together decide and get into conclusion, and it was the right. And there are a lot of many other examples, including Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, which I don't know if it's broadcast in Bulgaria, but in Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, these two survival hits that you can get. You get your friend, your telephone friends, and the audience in the auditorium. Apparently, when you ask the audience, 91% of the times they're right. They give you the right answer. Your telephone friends give you only 66% of the time the right answer. Somehow the audience in the auditorium know better than your phone friends. So what are the right condition in order that the wisdom of crowds will happen? We ask for four different conditions. One, that the audience will be, or the crowd will be diverse. Everyone have to think differently than the other. If all of us think alike, if you are the same with our thinking, there will be no wisdom crowd. There will be a group think, what we call it. We will be in the wrong direction. The second requirement is that we will be independent. Each of us need to decide alone about the right answer. If you sit in a director of boards and the general manager said, I think A, and everyone else after him said, A is the right answer, there will be probably no wisdom of crowds. In order that the wisdom of crowds will hold, we ask that the people will be diverse and independent and decentralized. Decentralized in the mean that they need to be able to learn. The reason that the people in the ox weight guessing game succeed to guess the right weight, because they saw the ox. If I told you that there is some ox somewhere in Sofia on the stage, please guess his weight, probably the group will not be able to guess the right weight because they even not saw the ox. So the group need to be diverse, independent, decentralized, and we need some technical aggregation mechanism or tool or way to collect the answers. A few years ago, I lectured before my oldest kid class. It was in the third year in school, around 9 years old. And I thought, I know something about wisdom of crowds. I will do the game, and I put a jar with a lot of candies inside and said, OK, let's guess how many candies there are in the jar. And I asked the first kids, how many And he said, I think there is 28. And all the class after him, 28, 29, 28, 29, because I didn't have the right aggregation mechanism to collect all the answers. And what I want to claim now, that crowdsourcing, Wikipedia, and the other tools that we discuss in a few minutes are the right aggregation tool in order to make the wisdom of crowds. They can give you the ability to collect many answers in one centralized place that can show us the right outcome that we want. So here, again, in the same example, we can choose many, many people which know almost nothing about all the things, or to collect few experts and pay them a lot, but they can produce something similar. If you look at the Wikipedia example, for example, the Wikipedia have almost, the English Wikipedia have almost 3,000 amateurs that contribute 4.5 million articles in 30 years. And they do almost the same job as the Britannica experts, who have only 4,000 experts which produce 80,000 articles in 200 years of development. Nature gave Britannica the grade 8.8, and Wikipedia in the same measurement got 8, which is quite similar between them. So let's talk about crowdsourcing and see how we combine all into one place. Crowdsourcing, I define as an online distributed problem-solving and production models. Users, is also known as crowd, typically form into online communities based on a website, and crowd submits solution to site or product its content. Crowds can also sort through the solution, finding the best one. The best solution are won entirely by the broadcaster, which we'll call him crowdsourcer. If we have a winning individual, he also gets some reward or some prize, which can monetary one or non-monetary one. Many individuals, and I will show you the statistics for fun, are participants just for the intellectual stimulation. They like to participate in this kind of sources. They give them a lot of recognition, rewards, emotional ties, friends, etc. So they enjoy to use it and do not do it for any reward. I remind you from yesterday's lecture, we call this part intrinsic motivation, the motivation that comes from you. And the second point, this one, is extrinsic motivation, that you do something for the reward. Benefit of crowdsourcing to company. Companies can exploit a problem with no cost or with little cost. As a company, you pay by results. If you get the right answer, if you get the right solution, if you get the right idea, you pay for it. If no, there is no payment. We can tap a wider range of talent. Maybe we don't have it in our organization. My organization is know nothing about X, so I crowdsourcing it to outsiders and ask them whether you know something about X or Y. I can turn my customers into designers. I can turn my customers into my partners. I can involve and engage my customers in my company. I can turn customers into marketers, etc. So there are many benefits for a company to do a crowdsourcing initiative. There are some challenges that we need to tackle before we jump into the crowdsourcing pool. What is quality? We need to make sure that the crowds done a quality work. It's not always the case. If I ask someone to sort something or to point on something and to do something, I need to check the quality of the work. There is a potential, as Eli showed you, Dr. Meron showed you yesterday, of intellectual property leakage. When I ask whether someone in the crowds knows something about X, you probably know that X is interesting. So some property can leakage outside. It's hard to do a time constraint. I can't ask you to do me a job and to do it quickly and to deliver deliverability until our 2 days do. There's not much control. It can disengage my own employees. If all the tough questions, the interesting one, the challenging one, I'm crowdsourcing to outside of my company, my own employees can think, okay, can be ill-willed or dismotivated by these initiatives. And the tough questions that I have is to choose what to crowdsource and what to keep in-house. Which few hints, which problems to outsource. Mainly, I will outsource if I have no internal expertise, if the problem is not essential or not critical. If this is my main issue or challenge in the company and all the companies realize about it, I will not crowdsource it. I even not outsource it. I will do it in-house. I will crowdsource problems that have no time constraint, that I can benefit the most from the involvement of the crowd. And usually, I will crowd one-time problems. So I think we spoke about diversity of opinion, independence, decentralization, and aggregations. So let's look about a few examples. What you see here is a map of many crowdsourcing applications or initiatives divided into different groups. And what I'm going to show you, I'm going to sample a few examples and show you what's the main idea behind them and how they work. I will start with this one. About this one, I spoke yesterday. It's called Foldit. It's the protein fold gains, which I hope that everyone go to his home and start to fold proteins all night until he succeeds. But now I want to talk about Galaxy Zoo. And from Galaxy Zoo, I move on to other applications until I think we cover some half of the groups that we have in. From each group, I choose or I pick only one application. Galaxy Zoo is a crowdsourcing platform that asks you to look on images, space images, and try to figure whether it's galaxy or not. In computer science, we have a problem of image processing. Usually, computer is not so good in recognizing images and decide what we are seeing. So we need the human eyes that are doing quite well to analyze pictures. So Galaxy Zoo asks his crowds, asks his user to watch picture and decide what it is, whether it's galaxy or no. It's launched on July 27. It's analyzed more than 1 million galaxies, 50 million classified in the first year from 150,000 visitors. And as a researcher, you can see that you can even publish papers about the products of Galaxy Zoo. What else? There is a community around Galaxy Zoo. You are not doing it alone. You are part of something big, that tries to analyze galaxies. Here's an example. This is a discussion forum. And someone asked, I watched this picture and I have a problem. Tell me, this round object is galaxy or not galaxy? And his friend answered him some answer. And someone else jumped into the discussion and tell his ideas. And finally, at the end, the initiator of the user, the first asker asked, thank you very much, and got into decision, and I decide that, I don't remember whatever, the puzzle is solved, thanks. Here, so the crowdsourcing is also sort of community. People talk about it, people involved into it. People do a good job in order to analyze galaxies. I mentioned that one of the problems of crowdsourcing is the quality problem. So NASA wanted to check how accurate are the crowds. And they asked people to circle the moon surface with special objects. And what they found is that this is the matches of experts. And on the bottom image, you can find the circles of the crowds. And they are almost identical. So if you give enough people to look at the picture and mark the poles on the moon surface, you get a very quality job and you get 14,000 free work, 14,000 hours of free work. Imagine that you have some work and you need a lot of work. You can attract moreover than 100,000 volunteers that do you a program that equal to 14,000 hours of free work and a quality work. So after we saw that there is a, can be a quality work, in 2007, Jim Gray, one of the database pioneers, took his yacht and sailed into the ocean and disappeared. So his friend and family put together this site, helped find Jim. They would ask people to try to figure this kind of shapes in these satellite pictures. Unfortunately, they didn't find it, and after a year, they declared him as a missing. But this is a kind of job that the crowds can do good. They could have helped to find Jim in the ocean. If you remember last year, the Malaysian airplane also, they asked the crowd to try to find this kind of shape with this size in this picture of the ocean water. So we can tap the crowd into some kind of work and do quite a good job in there. Let's see another few other examples. I will start, I talk about science crowdsourcing, now I want to talk about Ushahidi. Most of the sites I will show you are short videos of the site creators, the people that invented the idea in order to explain what is the site. Ushahidi is a platform. Okay, it's not a site.
Imagine a way for people all over the world to tell the story of what was happening to them or around them during a disaster or emergency situation. It would need to be easy to use, something that almost anybody can do, and it would need to be deployable worldwide. And that's why we've created Ushahidi. Ushahidi is the Swahili word meaning testimony or witness. Born from the post-election violence in Kenya in 2008, Ushahidi kept Kenyans current on vital information and provided invaluable assistance to those providing relief. It was deployed in the Democratic Republic of Congo to monitor unrest. Al Jazeera used it to track violence in Gaza. It was used to help monitor the 2009 Indian elections and to help gather reports globally about the recent swine flu outbreak. Anybody can contribute information, whether it's a simple text message from an SMS-capable phone, a photo or video from a smartphone, or a report submitted online. Ushahidi can gather information from any device with a digital data connection. After a report is submitted, it's posted in near real time to an interactive map that can be viewed on a computer or smartphone. But the most powerful feature Ushahidi offers is the ability to take the core application and deploy it yourself to suit your community's needs. Since Ushahidi is open source, anyone can improve the service in any way they see fit. Our growing community of developers are constantly at work improving Ushahidi to bring it to as many people as possible, including working to bring native applications to today's most popular mobile devices. With Ushahidi, it's easier than ever to get critical and timely information to those that need it most on a platform that almost anybody can use. That's Ushahidi. Ushahidi is the Swahili word for witness or testimony. Ushahidi, the software, allows for people to share their story.
Our mantra revolves around three things: the crowd, verification, and response.
Ushahidi is free and open source. Anybody can go to the web and download it and run their own platform tomorrow. It's that simple.
It allows a citizen to report, to indicate, hey, this is what's going on. The underlying thing is they can use whichever device they have in their pocket. And all that information is brought into a central location and mapped. So what we call geolocation.
The big mission that we're on, it's really to change the way information flows in the world, to give ordinary people a voice.
Ushahidi came about after the post-election violence in Kenya in early 2008. The election went south. The media houses were shut down. During that time, we started to see reports of violence come in on our blogs.
That very first week is when we built out this platform. It was this mashup of information coming from ordinary citizens, news reports, and we just plotted them on a map.
We just did what we could. We could do something. We didn't realize it would have this much of an impact.
Now, Ushahidi is available in more than 30 languages, in more than 159 countries.
There have been over 30,000 deployments of Ushahidi around the world.
Major impact in places like Haiti, Japan, Pakistan, Libya, you know, it's all over the world now.
One of the projects that we're working on in Kenya is that of the election.
Since our entire existence is out of the previous election in Kenya, we feel like it is our duty this time to be completely prepared for it. Today we have a really big meeting of people coming in to help us create this platform. It's not just us, it is for everyone, by everyone.
It's really about a free, fair, open Kenya elections and using Ushahidi's technology and knowledge about how to do crowdsourcing in order to make it so.
What technology does is give everyone a voice that was not there before. In a sense, it democratizes information. And then done the right way, it makes things a little more transparent.
The MacArthur Award will help this institution leverage technology in the service of citizens.
I think there's no better feeling of gratification that one can have than taking something that you hope can change the world and seeing it happen.
Within the two first examples, the Fold It and the Galaxy Zoo, we asked the crowd to be scientists, to do some science job. Ushahidi take the crowds and ask them, be a reporter. Report whatever you see. Tell us whatever you see, because this is accurate. But we get the crowd, take the crowd, and ask them to be advocates, to loan money to
others. A lot of us want to donate to charity. And there are many worthy organizations asking for our money. But we often don't know where our money goes and how much of it gets to people in need. On the internet, the rules of charity are being rewritten thanks to a boom in microfinance. In many countries, particularly in the third world, small-time borrowers need low-dollar loans. These budding business people don't want millions of dollars. A few hundred would do. Most banks won't touch loans that small, but a number of websites are now putting third worlders in touch with first worlders, like us, using our charitable urge to raise capital. Some microfinance sites are highly targeted, such as Wokai, which channels funds to rural China, and Namaste, which helps the poor in Guatemala and Mexico. Bigger and more ambitious are sites such as Microplace, which is owned by eBay, and GoodReturn.org, a new kid on the aid block, launched last year and based in Australia. These aim to deliver aid to people around the globe. The most successful is Kiva, established in 2005 by computer programmer Matt Flannery and his Stanford Business School wife, Jessica Jackley. The site partners with more than 50 microfinance organizations around the world. These groups put the money in the hands of those in need and then upload the story of each loan and photos of the borrower to Kiva's website, creating an online catalogue of people to help. How does it work? Hungry Beast decided to spend $50 to find out. We chose two third world business owners in need of help. Odunagunliye in Nigeria, who had plans to expand a small grocery store, and Kunthi Anam in Cambodia, who wanted to buy more pig feed to improve her livestock. The $50 was split evenly between them. The site is keeping us updated as the loans are repaid by Odun and Kunthia. The site then lets us withdraw those repayments or pass the money on to someone else in need. The same donation can go on to help many people. Traditional aid organisations often set aside a percentage of aid donations for admin costs. But this web-based model doesn't work that way. Its admin is funded from donations that are completely separate. We can choose whether to contribute to administration or to aid, or to both. This means 100% of the money we promise to developing nations ends up in developing nations. Since 2005, almost 750,000 people have used Kiva to lend $120 million to 300,000 recipients. The website's statistics are updated daily, and at present it claims that over 98% of loans have been repaid. Wokai has raised over $140,000, and Namaste has provided loans to more than 3,300 people in Guatemala alone. The bottom line here? We were able to provide a loan to someone in Cambodia in 15 minutes just by visiting a website. Online microfinance sites won't fix poverty on their own, but the global reach and personal connection of the web has the potential to make a huge difference.
So in this case, we ask the crowd to loan money to people that need it. For most of the people in the developed countries, $25 are not so much. They can handle, okay, can afford to give $25 to others. But for those people in the third world, in developing countries, it can make a huge difference when they get the 100 or something loan in order to build their business and to do some work. Kiva idea is after Muhammad Yunus from India, the Nobel Prize awarded about the idea that the crowds can open a bank. Actually, Kiva is a bank that loan money to the other. The idea behind Kiva, we call it crowdfunding. Okay, the crowds fund and other by loans, and we will see soon some more example about the idea. So to summarize a little bit, we talk about Folded and Galaxy Zoo, which is science, about citizen engagement, and about Kiva that contribute more. I want to show you an example of a creativity idea. It's called Threadless. And Threadless can convert each one of us to a designer, a t-shirt designer. And we can start design t-shirts and earn money by our designs. Here is how it works.
You dream it up, submit it, and we'll make it live. You vote on yours and hundreds more from 1 to 5.
And if you do get printed, well, then you get a surprise.
Cash money, watch your ideas come alive. You create and we all make great. You create and we all make great.
Welcome. In this video, you'll learn how to submit a design so you can earn fame and fortune on Threadless and beyond. Start by collecting these materials: a writing apparatus, a notebook, a computer, and an internet connection. You can use other tools as well. Think of an idea. Your idea can be anything. Original ones are best. Your idea can be funny, geeky, thoughtful, beautiful, and even a little weird. If you need an idea, use our theme design challenges for inspiration. However you make your idea, use a computer for the finishing touches. You might need help with your concept and execution. That's what the Threadless community is for. Put your design on a template once it's ready. Then press the submit button. We'll approve your submission in a couple days. Then your design will go up for scoring for 1 week. The Threadless community scores your design 1 to 5. Everyone can help pick what we make by scoring designs. Ask friends to help you out. If you'd like more people to score your design, vote on theirs. Be nice in the comments, though. Leave constructive criticism. Spend time on the forum, reviewing other submissions and reading threads. It's a great way to meet other artists and make new best friends. Your design gets a final score after 7 days. We review the top scoring submissions each week. Then we print the community's fave designs. We pick designs based on their overall scores and comments.
You got thread mail.
If your design is selected for print, you'll get tons of cash. We print your design on real-life t-shirts and ship them all over the world. Threadless prints on other products too, like water bottles, tank tops, and iPhone cases, which means you could earn more cash. Let's review the steps of earning fame and fortune on Threadless. Step 1, make an original design. Step 2, ask the community for help if you need it. Step 3, submit your design to Threadless. Step 4, promote your design ever so nicely on the forum and to your friends. Ask everyone to score it. Step 5, if we print it, you collect mad cash. So get started at threadless.com/make.
So if you look for next time earning and you're good in designing t-shirts, this is the place for you. The crowds will design the t-shirts for all of us. Here again, we took out of our company the designing of t-shirts and asked the crowds, come on guys, come and design our t-shirts, we will sell them and share the revenue between us. It's here, it's threadless.com. I will jump to this idea, which is quite similar to the Kiva idea. In the Kiva idea, the Kiva sites, we loan money to the other. Some associates look at the people in the developed country and offer them to work for us. We take our job, divide it into micro tasks, and ask everyone there to do a little work for us, pay them a little bit, because it's a small task, but for them, our little amount of money, and it's a huge that can let them live with dignity in their places. So it's called summer service.
Getty Images is the world's largest and best provider of digital media content, including video, stills, and music. We ingest millions of new digital media assets a year. One of the key and very important things in that process is assigning high quality metadata to those assets so that our customers can find the ones they want out of those millions of assets that they have at their fingertips.
So specifically when people search for celebrity names, they want to see pictures of those people and not just when they happen to be mentioned in the caption. And in order to do that, we have to have good search data. Samasaurus helps us create and maintain that data.
In a partner, we're looking for someone that can handle the volumes that we can generate and handle those volumes in a quality manner. Samasaurus was able to fulfill our business requirements and do that cost effectively, but they had the added benefit of being an impact provider.
Samasaurus is a nonprofit social business I founded 5 years ago that provides dignified digital work to women and youth living in poverty around the world. The way we work is we connect large technology enterprises with these low-income women and youth through our technology platform. We have paid and trained over 4,000 workers and moved 15,000 people out of poverty in the last 5 years. We've been able to bring Getty Images into northern Uganda, where we provide work to people who otherwise would have absolutely no way to use their skills to earn a living wage.
My name is Joran Buzabo. I'm the Supercenter Manager, and we have this project called GTY from Getty Images.
They upload for us images. You identify whether in that particular image that person exists.
After that, you can say, is he the only one in this image? So we categorize them in such a system such that it's easy for somebody who goes to get images.
Then we have supervisors who check the quality of that work After that, through the Summer Hub, we send them to our client, and then they are able to get it at their headquarter.
In Uganda, we have around 60% of the youth unemployed.
Every opportunity to create an extra job is a miracle.
This is the first time Microwork is here in Uganda. Had it been that Summer Source was not in Gulu, I don't know what I would be doing right now.
It has enabled us to support our family way back in the village from what we're earning.
This job helps me out a lot because I at least at the end of the day, I get something to share with my family. Some are still in school. I can at least help them out.
Having a job like this is such an honor for some of us. It's a very big opportunity.
Just all in all, it's been a great partnership. And we're very pleased with the quality, with the volumes and the throughput that we're able to achieve. They're able to grow with us as we've placed more and more demands on them.
I would recommend that other businesses work with SummaSource because they're very professional and very effective, and they would be a good partner even if they weren't trying to end poverty.
Yeah, I think the advantages are clear in working with an organization like SummaSource. If you can get the same quality and the same cost effectiveness, but have the added benefit of doing good in the world and supporting an organization that does that, it's a no-brainer.
Napkin Labs builds crowdsourcing platforms for leading brands on Facebook. We started Napkin Labs because we saw brands putting massive resources towards generating likes through ads, sweepstakes, and basic contests, but noticed brands struggling to create real business value out of their Facebook communities. We wanted to create a solution that would beef up engagement and give fans a voice to engage and collaborate with the brands they love. The result is FanCenter, a powerful crowdsourcing and community engagement tool. FanCenter is an extension of your Facebook brand page and gives fans a place to share ideas, feedback, stories, and rich content, all while earning points, rewards, and recognition. For brands, it is a customer engagement tool that delivers rich insights and ideas in real time that can inform marketing decisions and drive faster innovation. Through rewards and social interactions, FanCenter also generates brand awareness and drives sales. FanCenter integrates into your brand page as a tab. Inside FanCenter, fans can share ideas.
Okay, this application is to create a fan center, which I'm not going on with it. It's called Napkin Labs. I want to jump into another idea of crowdfunding. I don't know if it's popular here in Bulgaria. It's called Kickstarter. Do you use Kickstarter? Okay, so we know a little bit about
since its creation, the internet has
it's a way to raise money
for artists
from the
creative types to share and promote their work.
Unfortunately, this increase in use sometimes makes it more difficult to discover artists that are serious about developing their ideas and to find work that is genuinely unique and inspiring. It's also nearly impossible to support these artists until they have actually produced something you can buy. Enter Kickstarter. Since 2009, this fundraising platform has helped to bridge the gap between the artist and the consumer. In less than 2 years, Kickstarter has helped artists of all kinds raise millions of dollars to fund their dreams. As a member of Kickstarter, you can share in the creative process of other artists by contributing funding to their projects. You can also share a creative project of your own and receive funding from other members to help during the developmental stage of your project. By participating in the Kickstarter community, you can make sure that the creative ideas that inspire you are fully realized. Head to Kickstarter.com to peruse all the great projects and ideas floating around. Or, if you want to take a more active role, join the site. Click the Sign Up tab on the top right corner of the page. Enter your name, email address, and desired password. Or click to sign in with Facebook. Once logged in, click Me, then My Profile in the upper right-hand corner, and update your profile with a picture and some information about yourself.
Okay, in Israel, Kickstarter is a huge success. Many of my students, not many, some of my students have ideas, they upload them to Kickstarter, they raise the money that they want in order to build their idea, and one of them already shipped his idea. He invited it's called Pressy. It's a little bot, and that you put on the ear jack in a phone that you can program to do different things. If you have an idea and you don't have the initial money to build your business, you can use Kickstarter in order to crowdfund, to ask the other to fund your idea and to raise money in order to build your dreams and make it happen. I think I will talk a little bit about Innocentive, because Innocentive is different from all other examples that we show until now. Until now, we show examples that we ask the crowd to do something together. In Innocentive, we post a challenge, a question, that can be an easy one or a tough one. For example, it can be, I need tasty cookies for diabetes people. Or it could be, I'm looking for cure weights. Can be very daily life questions, can be tough one also. And we look not on the average of the people that we solve it, but we looked for the one that know the good answer for my questions. Okay, so Innocentive use the crowd as a kind of place to find the only one or the real one that know the answer for the problems. And there was many, and he got a monetary reward for his answer. For example, this company asked for blueprint and medical transportation device for combat rescue, and she offered $50,000 for the people who will solve this challenge, and there are almost 1,000 active solvers which submit solutions to the company in order to receive this amount of prize.
How do you innovate better, faster, and with less risk while ensuring that your company stays competitive and achieves sustainable revenue growth and profit? Introducing Innocentive, the industry pioneer in open innovation, crowdsourcing, and prize competitions. We enable businesses, government agencies, and nonprofits to generate creative new ideas and solve problems by connecting them to diverse communities of problem solvers, including employees, customers, partners, and the world's largest problem-solving network, which reaches over 12 million creative and diverse minds. Innocentive's business revolves around the concept of overcoming challenges, which at the core are well-formed problems whose solutions have value. Our customers use us to identify, develop, and run challenges as private or public competitions with award-based incentives. Our customers maintain full control over the process, including the audiences to which the challenges are presented, as well as the award amounts, which can range from $500 to over $1 million. Challenges come in a variety of forms, from brainstorming and general idea gathering for marketers seeking insight from customers, to complex technical or scientific problems, which, if left unaddressed, may derail an important development effort. We also run grand challenges, which are highly visible and valuable challenges that are uniquely tailored for each customer. Solutions to these unique challenges typically have far-reaching benefits to humanity and the world. For more than a decade, Innocentive has run thousands of challenges across a wide range of disciplines while successfully managing intellectual property and protecting the anonymity of our customers. We typically work with our customers in two primary ways. We help you to identify ideas and needs and run challenges to quickly solve problems affecting specific programs. Time to value is often short, a matter of weeks depending on the type of challenge. Or you can leverage our cloud-based innovation platform and expert services to help you develop an open innovation capability that spans your division or entire organization. These longer-term engagements start delivering value almost immediately, and we also provide options for running trial programs. For all of our solutions, we provide ongoing support, coaching, and training. Innocentive's goal is straightforward. We want to help you achieve measurable innovation and business outcomes. Our business model is based on paying for solutions, not work or failure. We strive to fundamentally change your economics of innovation and problem solving. Leading organizations partner with Innocentive to harness the power of open innovation, crowdsourcing, and prize competitions to solve problems and innovate faster, more cost-effectively, and with less risk than ever before. Are you ready for the challenge? Visit www.innocentive.com or call 1-855-CROWD-NOW to get started.
Some statistics about the incentive, and the one that are more interesting than the other, that most of the solutions come from only ones. Only 30% award more than one time in the lifetime. Other interesting that most solutions submitted the problem solved, which is not surprise. But what is surprise is that when the problem solved, when we have a more heterogeneous solutions, which means that we look for people not from the field of the problems. An oil company looked for a solution for a leakage oil that was deep in the oceans, and the solution came from a building contractor. He knows something about concrete, but knows nothing about oil. Because we look for the heterogeneous solution from experts, not on the field of the problems. Because usually if the problem is tough, we already ask the expert in these solutions. We look for innovative ideas, for new ideas, for ideas outside of the box, which sometimes or most of the times come from outside thinkers. Most of the people say that they, not most, but many people are not coming from the extrinsic motivation. They are not coming for the money, they're coming from intrinsic motivation, they come from the challenge to say, hey, I am the guy that, or I am the woman that solved the problem that I faced, and not because of the money award that they can receive. The world or the area of crowdsourcing is not always so accurate as I try to claim. And sometimes people pay for the crowds to change the view or to bias what we know. Here is one example of the China's government that paid for positive posting about them in order to bias the crowd's opinion. And here is another company that pay for submitters in order to bias what we know about the products. So we need to take care about what we read and what we are doing in the crowdsourcing. I think my time is almost over, so I will skip about the DARPA competition about the red balloons and Mechanical Turk, which is an Amazon tool to do some micro works. We're not talking about it. It's on the slides. Maybe I will talk about this only, but in Mechanical Turk, when people receive work and doing it for Amazon, you can see again that money, only money, is not the only motivator of people. Some people come for fun, and some people come to kill time. And there's many other reasons apart from the money that people come to crowdsourcing idea. To wrap up my lecture, we began the lecture with some models how to think about crowdsourcing, that we need a huge crowds in order to get utility and to work, and we need to understand the wisdom of crowds in order to evaluate if the crowdsourcing job is quality. We have a new business models and the new opportunities for us as a businessmen, thinkers, customers, designers, works. Crowdfunding is a way to raise money from the crowds, and microtask is the idea to break a large work into micro pieces and give each one a micro piece of work to do, and then aggregate it back at the end. Thank you very much.
Вие се запознахте основно вчера с базата на краудсорсинг, мъдростта на тълпата като цяло, нейната сила, полезността. Колкото повече членове, толкова повече полезността се увеличава. И в началото професор Равит ни показа именно от вчера спомена за платформата Foursquare, която ние точно показахме, и Facebook, разбира се, че популярността расте както на Facebook, така и на този нов тип платформи. Той е доста примерен и ни представи тук. В началото той разгледа исторически как се появява идеята да се използва силата на тълпата и показа няколко модели, като силата на връзките, тези схеми, които той показва, на някои от вас са познати, но интересно беше, че началото е някъде в 1906 година, аз си отбелязах, Франсис Галтън, когато още тогава модела Йохари се появява и се отчита, че експеримента, който е направен, да се питат 787 човека колко е теглото на вола, и когато са питани експерти колко е теглото на вола, и когато в една група фактически са включени не само хора от областта на животновъдството, въобще шарена, така да се каже, група, тълпата отговаря 1197 паунда, а истината е била, когато са изтекли вола, 1198 паунда. И още тогава фактически се вижда колко точно тълпата може да определи даден параметър. И се вижда другото, че една тълпа не е необходимо да бъде само от експерти. Т.е. трябва да има голямо разнообразие. И аз затова отварям сега една скоба, това го няма тук, казвам само. Аз съм споменавала пред някой от вас, че екипа на Google, например, компанията, не се състои от компютърни специалисти само. Вътре има художници, вътре има спортисти, вътре има хора, които са много далеч от компютърната наука като цяло. Примерите, които ни показа професор Равит, например, с катастрофата на Челенджър, той фактически, колеги, показа емблематични примери. И с Вола примера в теорията на краудсорсинга, и с Челенджър, и с подводница за Скорпион. Това са емблематични примери, те могат да бъдат прочетени в интернет. Наистина, научните дебати тогава не помагат при тези катастрофи. Тогава се наистина обръща научното тяло, т.е. научната мисъл, към интернет аудиторията. И това, което се открива от неговите така фотоси, се забелязваше, че отговора, който дава, колективният отговор, който дава тогава аудиторията, е бил много близък, т.е. 220 ярда само от истинското местоположение на подводницата. Аз обаче все още продължавам да се питам, защо тълпата, може да го попитаме, не дава този отговор за малайзийския самолет. Ако в момента някой има време, защото всичко е въпрос на време, да чете какво върви по форумите или пък по други сайтове с малайзийския самолет като решения, има много. Има много твърдения. Но официално твърдение на осведомителните агенции, имам предвид, не е излязло. Но можем да го попитаме, неговото мнение. По отношение на примерите, той спомена Стани Богат, при тях се нарича Стани Милионер, но той е едно и също, няма значение по целия свят, едно и също. Фактически, големия процент верен отговор винаги дава публиката. А когато се обадиш на приятел, процентът е много по-малък. И той ги спомена тези проценти. Освен това, най-важното, което трябва да отбележим, освен тези примери, разбира се, това са изискванията, за да оценим качеството на това, което решава тълпата. Като тълпата, разберете в кой смисъл, разбира се, на думата, но понеже на английски кралче тълпа, и за това така говорим. Общото мнение. Трябва да има няколко изисквания, които са на лице, за да може да се използва това като подход в компанията. А именно, различност в мнението, независимост, децентрализация и в крайна сметка събиране, обобщаване на тази информация чрез методите на компютърните технологии. Той си даде пример какво той е направил със своето дете, със своите студенти. Примера с бомбоните. ако така някой обърна внимание. И се оказа, че децата, т.е. искаше да спомене с този пример, всъщност да усетим, че възрастта може да е много ниска, на 9 години е неговото дете. Те са успели, когато попитал колко е, колко са бобовите в турбичката, и разликата само е била с един бобон. Пак такова допитване, което той прави по този начин. Професионално се интересува, разбира се. Като най-добър метод е в момента всичко това, което ние наричаме Wiki. Тоест, Wiki е създадено точно, за да можем ние да споделяме нашите знания с света, за да обогатява информационната база в целия свят. Wikipedia е на лице, Wikileaks е на лице и много други Wiktionaries, примерно Wiktionary е Wiktionary. Wiktionary всички ползваме, без да го усещаме, примерно. Вече не ползваме другите пречници. Wikinews, примерно, и така нататък. Примера при него беше даден, че Британика, енциклопедията, която за нас беше нещо много висше, много, така бих казала, обобщаващо, най-доброто, което можехме да ползваме, Британика. 4000 експерта създават тази енциклопедия и в крайна сметка 80 000 статии са статиите, които съществуват в Британика. Никой вече не говори за Британика. Има Британика онлайн, но ние ползваме фактически всички Википедия. В момента, по данни, т.е. една изрезка, защото това не е цялото, една изрезка, 300 000 непрофесионалисти създава 4,5 милиона статии. И вие знаете всички в Wikipedia какъв е контрол. Аз съм питала мои студенти. Примерно, ако ние напишеме Варна е град в Балкана, английски, разбира се, някъде около 20 минути сме си правили този експеримент с студенти, след около 20 минути тази статия я качим, нали, веднага се поправя. Вие може също да си го опитате, защото редактирането не е толкова сложно. При краудсорсинг изключително важно е участието на отделните умове. Тези умове се включват вътре, не водени от някакви други подбуди, а на първо място от интелектуална стимулация и удовлетворение. Затова печалбите за една организация, използвайки краудсорсинга, могат да бъдат много големи при решаване на проблеми с малки разходи. Но има и негативни страни, които трябва да бъдат избегнати, т.е. проблемите при краудсорсинга. Проблемите, той посочи няколко проблема. На първо място, качеството на решаване на проблема. Естествено, че в корпоративен аспект нещата стоят много по-детайлизирано, много по-ангажиращо. Но в крайна сметка, примерите, които видяхте с научните проблеми за, да речем, с водницата или пък челенджър и така нататък, е в крайна сметка също един добър пример. Но това трябва да си има предвид като заплаха. Освен това, изтичането на интелект. Ако се решава по този начин проблема, това значи, че проблема излиза извън корпорацията и вече за него се знае навън. Така че трябва да има един баланс между използването на подхода краудсорсинг в корпоративен аспект, имайки в предвид положителните и негативните страни. Освен това има и други проблеми, свързани с, примерно, времето, за което ще се реши проблема в организацията и така нататък. Платформите, които бяха показани, Galaxy, Galaxy Zoo, Help Find Jim, Ушахиди. Аз смятам, че когато върви филмче, много по-лесно нещата вие ги възприемате, защото виждате и чувате, даже има и текстове някой път. Galaxy беше показан като пример за това как доброволци идентифицират кратерите на Марс. Имаше едни снимки, в които първо каква е била научната задача като решение и след това, след включването на доброволците през интернет, идентификацията на много повече кратери. Лодката в океана на Джим, когато трябва да се намери Hellfire Jim, така се появява фактически и проекта, и Ушахиди беше разгледан най-много. Ушахиди фактически е доста известно, бих казала, средство, към което се обръщат в целия свят, особено хора, които се занимават с разпространение на информацията. Когато трябва да се открие нещо, на момента да се разбере и в същото време другата страна пък за предоставяне на информация. Тоест, много хора предоставят информация на ушахиди. Може би някой ще каже, защо в България не са толкова популярни тези проекти, тези платформи. Аз бих казала, че не са популярни на неинформираните хора. И аз от тук нататък искам вече да считам, че вие сте в другата категория на информираните хора. И когато един потребител е информиран, вчера споменахме, той се чувства много по-автономен, много по-свободен. Това са ушахиди, което беше разказано, колко са били подпомагани хора от държави Уганда, Кения, Индия и така нататък, как не са били добре предварително подготвени, примерно изборите да се проведат. И оттам са получили подкрепа. Общо 159 страни участват в този проект. Може да влезете да прочетете кои са тези страни, които са били подпомогнати по проекта Ушахиди. В първите два проекта, Galaxy и Help Find Jim, участваха и участват, разбира се, повече хора от научния свят, повече експерти, докато в Ушахиди участват абсолютно всякакви потребители от различен ранг, от различни краища на света, т.е. той е много по-популярен. Другите примери, които той ни посочи, това бяха примерите на Кива. Кива е инструмент, който е създаден 2005 година и цели да подпомага, да дава дарения, да дава заеми, да дава помощи. Статистиката, която посочи професор Радик, беше, че 98% от всички, които са се обърнали, един път са получили, не повече от един път, помощ от платформата. Но резултат, който би могъл да се получи само в рамките на 15 минути. Т.е. за много кратко време може да се получи реакция. И то какъв, примерно, може да бъде този тип резултат? Когато всеки един потребител от една развита държава даде, например, 25 долара, което е нищо за развита държава, това е половин или може би половин доход, необходим за един месец живот в някои от тези държави, за които споменах. Примерчето с Fredless.com, това са Fred, знаете, че е нишка, т.е. нещо свързано с дизайн на тъкани, а именно как ние можем да си направиме t-shirts, тениски. Интересни идеи. Първо той посочи всички стъпки. Търсим една интересна идея, след това тази интересна идея ние развиваме, правим си наш дизайн, пускаме си, събмитваме си предложението, изчакваме аудиторията да ни оцени и евентуално при набиране, аз вчера посочих нещо подобно, давайки примери, аз имах предвид Flickr, не се бях сетила за този сайт, но този сайт е също подобен. Когато евентуално ви подкрепи аудиторията, ви получавате повече точки и получавате съответна подкрепа за своята идея. Тълпата помага. Съответно, Sama Source е друга платформа за подпомагане, която той ни показа. Sama Hub е фактически възможност за намиране на работа. 65% безработицата в Уганда, която той показа, и съответно интервютата на хората, които са намерили някаква реализация през този сайт. Но нека се позамислиме, в България нямаме ли подобни проблеми? И накрая, предизвикателствата към всички нас, към всички вас, Kickstarter и Innocentive. Тези колеги платформи, едната е създадена 2009 година, т.е. те са сравнително нови, другата малко след нея. Това е връзка между потребители и разработчици. връзка между пазара и това, което се търси на пазара. Креативни идеи, възможност да качите вашето именно иновативно решение, други да го подпомогнат, други да го поемат, както се казва, и вашия стартап бизнес, т.е. да стартираш бизнес, да може по-малко с подкрепата на група да тръгне напред. Подобна платформа е Иносентив, освен за решаване на проблеми, които вие имате в бизнес, било в разработка на някаква стратегия, било то в решаване на някаква спешна задача, било то при търсене на пазари, осигуряване на подкрепа, отново тази платформа би могла да бъде използвана. И най-накрая, малко естествено споменато, но трябва да се има предвид, вчера също акцентирахме върху негативната страна, как може да бъде манипулирана тълпата. Примерите, които бяха дадени тук, че компаниите плащат, за да бъде показана в интернет една друга страна на нещата. Това беше нашето обобщение. Аз сега моля за въпроси, ако има, призовавам ви. Времето в програмата, което е за демонстрации и за въпроси, е наше време. Така че, дали ще демонстрираме това, което в момента гледахме, дали ще демонстрираме нещо, което е било от вчера, това е вашето време. Така че, гъвкави сме в програмата, задавайте си въпросите, тъй като след още 1-2 часа и няма да имаме тези експерти пред нас. Така че използвайте, сега може да ни превеждаш, изцедете ги колкото можете, защото усещате, може би, някои от вас, ако са написали в интернет техните имена, че това са хора от много голяма величина. И така, имаме ли въпроси? Аз в кавички се го казвам да ни превеждаш. So, I would like to ask you something. You mentioned the case with the Malaysian. What about your opinion? Why we didn't have till now any solution, official solution? Because we have read a lot in internet sources and sites about different ideas for finding I don't know what's your opinion. I'm curious.
I think they didn't find it because it didn't appear in the satellite images. I think if it were in one of the images, they probably find it. I read them yesterday in the newspaper that they have new ideas what happened there. They send some marines to look at it, but it's not something that the crowd can help to solve because submarine is expensive equipment. So I think if it was where something on the images that someone can solve, it was solved already. I think it's too quickly sunk into the ocean and only submarine or some other equipment can find it.
Разбрахте ли, че е изключително скъпо да се изпратят подводници, да се търсят, макар че има вчера, той спомена, че вчера са излезли нови данни за местонахождението на самолета, но се счита, че това е много скъпа операция. Where is the area where the airplane is? Is there any
I think they have something.
Boundaries?
I think they have
that area.
I think they have something.
They have.
Yes. I think the Australians define some kind of area.
Is that area
it.
Very huge?
Yes.
It's huge. Very huge. Mm-hmm.
Enormous. Yes. But maybe they need experts like to have an idea with the submarine to try to figure with the crowds where exactly it was. I'm not sure they collect enough experts. Try to do it in that way. But as I mentioned yesterday, the Israeli airplane said something. New theory, what's happened there, where to find the same ships to this area to go for. So maybe we have a hope.
Thank you. Мисля, че разбрахте, огромна е територията, която е очертана, но все още не е използвана мъдростта на тълпата в този случай. Той се надява, че както при подводницата на Скорпион, нещата са били решени накрая по този начин. Може би и тук той се надява, че ще се използва краудсорсинг.